Good morning, everybody, and welcome to the first meeting of the Citizen Engagement and Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee of 2023. And this morning we have principally issues concerning the continuing petitions that we wish to discuss, and also the first consideration of some new petitions. The first petition we'll have a look at this morning is petition number 1864, which is to increase the ability of communities to influence planning decisions for onshore wind farms. This petition was launched by Aileen Jackson on behalf of Scotland Against Spin. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to increase the ability of communities to influence planning decisions for onshore wind farms by adopting English planning legislation for the determination of onshore wind farm developments, empowering local authorities to ensure local communities are given sufficient professional help to engage in the planning process, and by appointing an independent advocate to ensure that local participants are not bullied and intimidated during public inquiries. Now, we last considered this petition on the 29th of June last year, when we agreed to explore a number of the issues that were raised by writing to the Minister for Public Finance, Planning and Community Wealth, UK Government Ministers, Planning Aid Scotland and the Scottish Government's Planning and Environmental Appeals Decision. And we've now had responses received from all of the bodies I've just mentioned. The DPEA set out the training and advice provided to reporters when conducting public inquiries, and they noted that reporters are advised to be alert and to intervene if they perceive that cross-examination of witnesses is becoming overbearing. Planning Aid Scotland say all their staff and volunteers are required to be chartered planners. While they have not recently provided training relating to public inquiries, they say they will continue to monitor the type of advice requests received and use this to inform the training being provided to their staff and volunteers. They would welcome the Scottish Government undertaking research into how support could be provided for communities participating in public inquiries. Following the evidence session with the Minister, the committee received clarification that the Scottish Government do have powers to alter the 50 megawatt threshold for renewable energy developments, but the Scottish Government has not explored the benefits or disadvantages of doing so. And while they declined to comment on the specifics of the petition, both the Secretary of State for Scotland and the UK Minister for Energy indicated the UK Government's willingness to engage constructively with the Scottish Government on planning matters. Now, we've also received two new submissions from Aileen Jackson, who is, of course, the petitioner, commenting on the responses received. And Aileen welcomes the Minister's clarification on the power of the Scottish Government to alter the 50 megawatt threshold, I think a matter Mr Ewing raised in examination. And she considers that this potentially opens the possibility for more decisions on proposed wind farm development to be taken at a local authority level. Aileen also highlights UK Government proposals for changes to national planning policy on onshore wind farm developments in England. And of course, that's all coupled with the Scottish Government's, the UK Government's willingness to work with the Scottish Government in these matters. So, colleagues, we've had quite a lot of, I would say, constructive feedback from the various bodies to whom we wrote. And I wonder if, arising from that, colleagues individually might like to suggest ways we might take things forward from here. David Turns.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if a committee could write to the Scottish Government setting out the committee's recommendations based on the evidence gathered so far. That this might include recommending that the Scottish Government undertake work to explore the benefits and disadvantages of altering the 50 megawatt threshold for consideration of renewable energy developments, undertake research into how support could be provided for communities wishing to participate in public inquiries into planning decisions, including onshore wind farm developments, explore the scope for planning authorities to determine more applications for onshore wind farm developments, and explore opportunities to ensure and demonstrate of local support is a key material consideration for planning authorities when determining applications for onshore wind farm developments.
I'm content with that. I might also, in asking the government to undertake an exploration of the benefits and disadvantages, draw to their attention or provide for them the letter we've received, or the response we received from the UK government saying they'd be very happy to engage on that, on the whole matter as well, which would be useful. Fergus Ewing.
Yes, on the issue of engagement with the UK government, I mean, I think particularly in the light of the fact that the whole development of wind on and offshore will be dependent to some extent upon grid upgrade and interconnector capacity expansion, and particularly with regard to the interconnectors crossing borders, convener, if we could recommend that the case for cooperation between the Scottish and UK government is not just strong, it's just a sine qua non of delivery of the respective renewable energy aims and ambitions of both governments, and that maybe a standing committee might be the way to deal with this, given the nature, complexity, breadth of the issues involved. And secondly, in relation to the work that Mr. Torrance has suggested be done, could we ask in particular that the Scottish Government, in their response, state what implications alterations would have, both on cost and time, on the cost of dealing with applications, which may be considerable were the petitioners asked to be granted, especially if independent advocates were to be appointed, and secondly, the length of time which may be added to applications. And I say that because as a former energy minister, I remember opening one wind farm which had taken about 13 years to go through the planning process and about 13 months to build, and I'm not sure that anyone really gains from delay of that magnitude. So I have that in mind, but that could be anecdotal, and I don't have a clear picture, but I think those two issues, I would quite like to see the facts on those two issues from the Scottish Government and perhaps from others, the planners and local government side, if that's appropriate.
I think we can accommodate all that. Thank you. Are we content to proceed on that basis? We are. I should say for the record that we are joined by two of our parliamentary colleagues this morning, Faisal Chowdhury and Rhoda Grant, who so missed us that she is joining us in relation to three petitions, two of which we're considering jointly. And Faisal Chowdhury joins us in relation to the petition we now move to, which is petition 1891, to make swimming lessons a statutory requirement in the primary school curriculum. This petition was lodged by Lewis Alexander Conde and calls on the Scottish Government, the Scottish Parliament, to urge the Scottish Government to ensure that all children will have the opportunity to learn to swim by making it a statutory requirement to provide lessons in the primary school curriculum. And I'll be inviting Mr. Chowdhury just to comment in a moment or two. We last considered this petition almost a year ago now, in January last year, on the 19th. And actually, we, as a committee, offer our sincere apologies to the petition for not bringing this petition back for further consideration in our schedule before now. But at our last consideration, we agreed to write to the Scottish Government, and I am pleased to say that we now have received a response from the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills. In her response, the Cabinet Secretary restates that there is no mandatory curriculum in Scotland, and local authorities and individual schools have the flexibility to decide on the content of lessons at a local level. The Cabinet Secretary does, however, go on to offer information about the Scottish Swimming Learn to Swim framework and the delivery model pilots that are taking place over the course of 22-23 to help educate and provide opportunities for children across Scotland to experience the water in a fun, safe and inclusive way. She has also highlighted the launch of the Water Safety Scotland and Education Scotland educational resource for schools to provide a consistent level of learning across Scotland's educational institutions. Mr. Chowdhury, I wonder if welcome, as I say, to our proceedings. And as is normal practice, when colleagues do, I'm very happy to offer you the opportunity just to comment on the petition and to speak to the committee.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And I would like to thank the committee for giving me this opportunity to come and speak to you all. As you said, I am disappointed that it has taken a year. Within the year, you probably heard so many accidents happened, quite a lot of death on swimming-related issues has taken place. And that is probably one reason the quite a lot of constituents came to us, and they wanted us to make sure that it is it is in the curriculum and the school students are taught. But as you have given the comments from the minister, but what I was wondering, I mean, if that if we can invite the minister and Kozla, obviously, to tell us why they feel that it shouldn't be in the school curriculum. And I would request the committee to leave the petition open. for the consideration. And as I said, majority of the stuff I've already said previously, nothing has changed from my previous presentation. And I'm in the hands of you all. And as I said, we have been speaking to schools as well, and schools feel the same, that if it is in the curriculum, students will learn to swim.
Okay, thank you. I mean, I in response to the first point, I think the Cabinet Secretary makes clear whether the committee might wish it otherwise or not, but that there is no mandatory curriculum in Scotland. So in that respect, there is no direction of the government in that regard. I have to say, you allude to deaths that have taken place amongst young children as a result of not being able to swim. And to be honest with you, I'm not aware of the incidence of that, which obviously is in itself a difficult matter to address. But colleagues, we've heard from Mr. Chowdhury, we've also, as I say, finally had this response from the Scottish Government. And I just wonder in reflection what consideration there is from colleagues as to what we should do. David Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. Considering the response we've had from the Cabinet Secretary and the Scottish Government, I would like to close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that there is no mandatory curriculum in Scotland, with the Scottish Government indicating that the Learn to Swim framework is being delivered in 27 out of 32 local authority areas, with progress being made within two further local authority areas towards delivering the framework in June 2023. And Water Safety Scotland and Education Scotland have launched an educational resource for schools to provide a constant level of learning across Scotland's educational institutes.
Colleagues, I mean, I'm obviously sympathetic to the representations we've received from Mr. Chowdhury. I mean, could we couple that with, notice to the petitioner, drawing their attention to the actions that the Scottish Government has indicated are being taken, but obviously pointing out to them the route forward in bringing a petition back in a year's time, if they felt that the provisions that the government have said are about to be fulfilled by local authorities and Water Safety Scotland have failed to address the issues that are concerned. I mean, I don't know that there's much more we could do at this stage, but we could draw to the petitioner's attention that route for the future. Mr. Ewing?
Yes, well, I should say I wasn't committee at the time the evidence was taken, but I have read the evidence and it covers both the desirability of kids learning to swim, but also the importance of that as a skill, as a life-saving device, which Mr. Torrance raised in questions I noticed from the evidence session. But in light of Mr. Chowdhury said this morning, I do feel that whilst I think we probably should close the petition for the technical reasons that have been said, it might be helpful if, in addition to the work you suggested, Convener, that we, in closing the petition, we also write to the Minister, stressing that we're closing the petition because there is no mandatory curriculum, and in that respect, it's a technical reason. However, whilst we welcome the progress that's been made, there are still some local authorities that are not apparently offering provision, that there are concerns that deaths have arisen, perhaps because of lack of ability to swim. Each of these cases probably would be subject to a fatal accident inquiry, and we don't necessarily know if those have taken place. Probably not, actually, if they occurred recently. Mm. But could we, in the letter, perhaps say that we've advised the petitioner to consider bringing back the petition in a year and really just ask the Scottish Government if they could confirm that they won't neglect attention to this matter, they will drive it forward with COSLA colleagues, and in particular they'll try to advance the causes that Mr. Chowdhury has spoken to eloquently this morning and the petitioner has advocated us to pursue.
Yes, I mean, I think that's quite a nice marriage of the different suggestions that have been made, and I think just means, although we feel the technical need to close the petition, that we haven't lost sight of the underlying issues and make clear, in a sense, that we're almost encouraging it to be brought back to us should the shortcomings prevail. And are we content to proceed on that basis? We are. Okay. Then thank you very much, Mr. Chowdhury. We move to petition number 1859, which is to retain falconers' rights to practice upland falconry in Scotland, brought to us by Barry Blyther, who I note is with us in the gallery this morning. This calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to amend the Animals and Wildlife Act 2020 to allow mountain hares to be hunted for the purposes of falconry. Members will recall our evidence session in December last year, I haven't quite got my head around everything yet, with the petitioner, the Minister for Environment and Land Reform, and Nature Scott, and I should say, and with Stanley, since I think we put questions to Stanley directly. We heard a number of issues in relation to this petition, and there are some outstanding issues and questions for us to consider, all of which have been summarised in our papers. Colleagues, Mr Ewing.
I'd just like to place on record a couple of matters
arising from
the evidence session, of which I had given notice to the clerk. First, at the outset of her evidence at the evidence session, the Minister said that I had been the Cabinet Secretary at the time. I did point out in the session that I was not the Cabinet Secretary responsible for that particular piece of legislation. The Minister then, however, added that the junior minister who took the legislation forward was the junior minister acting under both myself and Rosanna Cunningham. That is true. However, it does slightly give a false impression of the situation, and I wanted to correct that. I was, for the avoidance of doubt, I was not the Cabinet Secretary with direct responsibility for this bill. That was Ms Cunningham, and Ms Goujon took forward the bill on a practical day-to-day basis, acting on the instruction of Ms Cunningham. So I had no direct ministerial locus or policy role for that bill, although I was, of course, a member of Cabinet. Second, later on, the Minister went on to say that, quotes, if the solution Mr Ewing is referring to is that I instruct law officers to make a statement that a criminal offence will not be prosecuted, he is doing a disservice to the legal profession he was once part of. In response, Convener, could I point out that, first of all, I am still part of the profession, as I am on the role of solicitors, although no longer in practice. But of more substance is that I did not call for a blanket ban on prosecution, but rather for guidance. Guidance was what I sought, and guidance, I hope, is an option that can be explored. So I'll come to make further substantive remarks later, but I really just wanted to clarify those.
Thank you.
For the record, thank you for the opportunity.
No, not at all. I know that, colleagues, we were all impressed by the petition, and I think we were troubled by some of the evidence that we received. We've had an opportunity to reflect on that. I think there are a number of issues that arise. I think the direction of travel that the committee potentially is likely to journey upon is clear, but in pursuing that journey, are there suggestions to the committee as to what we might reasonably now do? And you know, it'll be good to hear from colleagues in relation to this. Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. There is no doubt that this petition has created some real anxiety across all areas. And when the Minister was here the last time, I think we were, as a committee, quite intent in trying to progress. And I think Mr Ewing has outlined in his way the things that needed to be corrected from the last session, and that has been. But I think it's important that we go back to the Minister. So I would be suggesting that we write to the Minister of Environment, Land Reform and National Scott on the outstanding issues that were raised, because there are still a number of them that need to be clarified. And these are existing licence processes and options. The circumstances which could constitute an offence and where a person could be charged and prosecuted, I think that's vitally important. However, the welfare of birds of prey, particularly large birds like eagles, can be ensured, and to the extent and to the content of new arrangements for the protection of mountain hares and the potential and the consequences of any legislative change. I think these are fundamental into what we need to be challenging at this stage. So I'd be proposing that we do that at the next level.
Okay. Do we have any other suggestions or comments from colleagues? Mr Ewing.
Yes, I agree with Mr Stewart's recommended course of action. And in doing so, I express my gratitude to the information and help we've received from SPICE, which we have had a briefing on earlier, and for which we're grateful. And in the light of that, I hope that we can use the information about the possible distinction between the use of birds, falconry, for hunting purposes and for exercise purposes, and draw that distinction in the face of the letter to the minister, and ask if, in particular, as well as the issues that Stuart has enumerated, that regard can be had to whether or not this might form the basis of her seeking guidance and advice from Nature Scott, who I gather deal with the operational and strategic arrangements for licences in general, to see if they can recommend a way that would enable the sport of falconry to continue to be exercised in the light of the distinction that we've had the benefit of hearing about this morning from Spice. In addition to that, I would hope we could write to Police Scotland, the Crown Office and the Procurator Fiscal to clarify the circumstances which would constitute an offence and whether a person could be charged and prosecuted. And in that letter, I think, again, it would be helpful for the benefit of the legal authorities, who, of course, have who are the only ones who have the right to decide whether or not there should be a prosecution. The minister, to be fair to her, has no such locus at all, and that line cannot be crossed. So I think we should be asking the prosecution authorities in what circumstances they may be minded to consider criminal proceedings, and perhaps also explore whether or not, and in the letter again, set out the distinction that we've had the benefit of having had explained to us this morning, so that they can see both the potential solution, but also the quandary that falconers face, and appreciate that this is something that the committee is taking very seriously. I think what I'm asking for, convener, is that the letters to both the legal authorities and the minister should go to some lengths to set out, if you like, our concerns about what we've heard and our desire for a solution to be found with everybody working together to that end.
I'm content with that. And I would like to suggest that in the light of the responses we might receive, that we would also then go back to Spice and ask them to draw that together in the form of a further briefing, which would then, I think, allow and inform us as a committee as to what steps we then take on the back of that, because clearly we want to arrive at a solution and we want to do that having underpinned that recommendation with every possible exploration of advice that we can to clarify all the outstanding points.
And perhaps I could just add a little addendum, which I forgot to say, but I meant to say, which is that perhaps at the very end of the letter to the minister, we could politely indicate that this is a matter where I think all members of the committee felt particularly exercised and concerned, and therefore it is our intention to pursue this and indicate that we do treat this very seriously indeed, and perhaps thereby inject a little bit of lead into the ministerial pencil.
And which analogy, I will ask if members are content. They are. Thank you very much. We then move on to consideration of petition number 1900, access to prescribed medication for detainees in police custody, a petition about which we've taken evidence, colleagues will recall, lodged by Kevin John Lawson. It calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to ensure that all detainees in police custody can access their prescribed medication, including methadone, in line with existing relevant operational procedures and guidance. Members will recall that we took evidence, as I mentioned, from former members of the Drugs Death Task Force and subsequently with the Minister for Drugs Policy. And we explored a range of issues in relation to the petition, including the use of dihydrocodeine, access to monitoring data, and implementation of the MAT standards. The committee has now received two submissions from Kevin, our petitioner, which are included in our papers, and corresponds from NHS Grampian to the Minister for Drugs Policy, that being an area that was explored in our cross-examination. The correspondence from NHS Grampian confirms that it is currently unable to administer MAT, including methadone, within a police custody setting. This, it states, is due to historic constraints and the absence of a controlled drug licence. The correspondence states that NHS Grampian has set up two short-life working groups, one of which is specifically tasked with completing the implementation of MAT standards within police custody. NHS Grampian is also looking to have a controlled drug licence in place by the end of February this year. In the light of the responses received, do my colleagues have any comments or suggestions for action? Mr. Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I would like to keep the petition open, Convener, but in doing so, can we write to the Minister for Drugs Policy, highlighting issues raised in the petition and related evidence, welcoming the work of the MAT Implementation Group to date, and highlighting ongoing concerns about resources, capacity issues within the health sector? Can we also ask for an update on the situation in NHS Grampian by the end of February, specifically if a controlled drug licence for police custody settings has been obtained and the timescale from completing the implementation of the MAT standards within police custody settings, and seek reassurances on the issues of capacity and monitoring of implementation across Scotland to ensure that the MAT standards are met?
I thought the confirmation of the position in NHS Grampian was disappointing, I have to say. And I think that in progressing this, we would want to give proper emphasis to that. Mr. Sweeney?
Thank you, Convener. I would agree with the recommendations suggested by Mr. Torrance, and would furthermore suggest that we might want to give consideration to direct engagement with health and social care partnerships where there are clear deficiencies in implementation of this specific MAT standard that we and the related MAT standards that we're discussing. And perhaps it might be an opportunity to actually seek evidence directly from those health and social care partnerships as to what the blockages or impediments are. And perhaps that could offer a way of us being useful in trying to get delivery expedited.
So that would involve us doing what, just to be clear?
Perhaps actually identifying potential health and social care partnerships where they aren't achieving those MAT standards and inviting the management of those health and social care partnerships to give evidence as to why that might be a problem.
Is that something we can explore? We could...
You could maybe ask the Minister to give evidence on the health and social care partnerships that are...
Yes, I'm just wondering how to pursue that in the round. I mean, what we obviously have is NHS Grampian expressing the fact that it hasn't been able to do so. Mm-hmm. And I wonder, therefore, without actually explaining to us why that is the case, we might pursue the point directly with them in the first instance as an example of an authority that's struggling. Mr. Ewing?
Yeah, I mean, I do... agree in principle with Mr. Sweeney's recommendation because these partnerships have a direct role to play. I wonder if in the first instance we could raise the point specifically in the letter to the Minister and perhaps couple that with a request that she provide us with a specific update as to what progress is being made in using the very substantial amount of money, and I'm very sorry I can't remember, was it 500 million? It was a very substantial amount of money that has been set aside for pursuit drugs policy objectives in general, and the indication the Minister gave was this to be used in large part to hire relevant personnel, whether as employees or whether as consultants or contractors, and in the case of the provision of services to detainees in police custody, plainly it may well be doctors and a provision of budget for doctors who would be hired by the police or other health professionals. I'm sorry, I'm being a bit long-winded.
Tease this out.
But I thought really a related way of pursuing Mr. Sweeney's point might be to ask the Minister specifically what progress has been made, how many additional people have been employed in each particular area, has she got that information? If not, will she get it? And can she give us a progress report on how that money has been spent thus far? Because that gets to the nitty-gritty. I mean, a very substantial amount of money, but what is it being used for? It's not easy to hire people, the right people, quickly. It's a difficult, complex task, but I know the Minister is entirely devoted to this. And, I think all members would be interested in more factual information about these issues.
I accept that, but I'm mindful of the petitioner as well in relation to all of this. And I just wonder whether, in the first instance, what we want to understand is the position in NHS Grampian is a specific... a specific level area focus of the inquiry to the Minister in the first instance.
Fine, but I think probably it would be of interest to yeah. all parts of Scotland.
Right. Can we try draft something? I think maybe if we could draft something that we could maybe just consider before we send off, I think that would be helpful for us to do. So can I suggest that we ask the clerks to produce a draft of the letter? Mr. Sweeney?
Sorry, Convener. It was just to follow up on that point. I think what was interesting in the correspondence from NHS Grampian was this issue of the controlled drug licence, and they're seeking to try and implement it by the end of February. So it would be interesting, almost they're offering themselves as a pilot of how to rapidly implement that controlled drug licence. So it would be really helpful to get that kind of insight from that health board or that health and social care partnership as to how they achieved it and what the impediments were. And then perhaps that might offer an insight for the minister and indeed the parliament to actually show how we could get this process sped up for other health authorities, other health and social care partnership areas, so we can try and get this rolled out, because it seemed that that was the key sticking point identified in the correspondence. So if we could kind of break through that bureaucratic issue, that might be something that we could focus on.
Yes, I think that makes sense. So we'll accommodate all of that. And I think I'd just quite like for us to, even by correspondence, perhaps, just to see a draft of the potential letter that we would send to the minister. Are we agreed? Thank you. We move to petition number 1902 to allow an appeal process for community participation requests lodged by Maria Aitken on behalf of the Caithness Health Action Team. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to allow an appeal process for community participation requests under the Community Empowerment Act of 2015. Now, at our previous consideration of this petition, we identified that work is ongoing to identify the possibility of an appeals process. As part of the Scottish Government's own review of the Act, the Minister for Public Finance, Planning and Community Wealth has informed us that the Scottish Community Development Centre's working group continued its work through 2022 to explore the potential for an appeals or review process for participation requests and will bring its findings to the Scottish Government for full consideration. As I mentioned earlier on, we have Rhoda Grant with us this morning. And I just wonder, Rhoda, if there's anything further you'd like to suggest to us, given that information.
Yes, and I'm a wee bit disappointed with that response, because it means that there won't really be any change to policy until much later this year and maybe realistically into next. And in the meantime, I think Caithness Health Action Team should really be recognised as a community organisation under the Community Empowerment Scotland Act, because they really spend a lot of time representing their community. Now, I wonder if the committee would consider writing to NHS Highland. I understand they're working with CHAT now in a much more positive fashion. And I wonder if the committee would consider asking them if they would now be willing to recognise CHAT, or certainly give them the same input and status as they would have had if they'd been recognised under the Act. I mean, more and more often CHAT are coming to me with issues from their community. They're well recognised. People turn to them for guidance and representation with health issues. And I think it could only help NHS Highland and indeed the wider community if they were around the table with that. So I wonder if the petitions committee would consider doing that and maybe just keeping this open till we get some form of resolution, because obviously the work that's being done by Scottish Government isn't really going to resolve this issue in the near future.
Okay, thank you. I mean, one strand of thinking that you articulated there, which does register with me, is we don't really have any timetable going forward as identified here. I mean, simply that work was done in 22 and that will lead to findings being brought to the Scottish Government for consideration, which I think, as Rhoda Grant said, reasonably doesn't give us a timeline going forward. I mean, that could be any time, and then the government could take any time to consider, and there could be any time after that before anything is suggested that might follow as a consequence. So I do wonder if we might... If we might try to seek to ask the Scottish Government or whoever the appropriate body is for a slightly more accountable time frame that this could be held to. I mean, I don't know that there's much more after that we can do. I'm not sure that the suggestion from Rhoda Grant is one for the committee, or whether it's one a more personal intervention? Do colleagues have any thoughts?
Convener, I think you make a very valid point about the timescale on the process, and Rhoda Grant herself does make some views, but as you've identified, I'm not quite sure how we as a committee could actually progress that. We can ask for the timescale to be come back, but other than that, I think we're quite limited as to where we are, considering there has been already some development from them as to what they plan to do, or they've indicated they plan to do. But as you've said, the timescale is the problem, because we don't know how long that's going to take, and it could be towards the end of this year before anything actually happens.
Yeah, and I think our expressing an interest in pursuing it might ensure that something is pursued. Mr. Ewing?
Yeah, I think Rhoda Grant's raised a fair point here. And, generally speaking, I think if the government says, well, in response to any request for action, well, we might get around to doing something one day, that's no very good. And I don't think we as a committee should actually accept that in principle. But I do think, we should probably word it in the more moderate and way with politesse that you have advocated, rather than the words I've just deployed. But I think we should press the issue and say we would like more a specific response about when the government plans to take any action. And but at the same time, I do actually agree with you, Convener, that I'm sure Ms. Grant will not be backward in coming forward and making her own representations, and it may well be a matter for individual MSPs to pursue in their constituency or region as well.
Can we explore, I just think the further suggestion Rhoda Grant made, if we can just explore the most appropriate way that we think that might be accommodated, either through the committee or by some other means. But are we otherwise content to proceed on that basis, colleagues?
Yes,
we are. Thank you. That brings us to petition number 1918, Improving Sex Education in Schools, lodged by Kate Friedman. And this calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to reform sex education by updating guidance and implementing clear teaching rules focusing on topics such as menstruation and related illnesses, puberty, LGBT sex, including asexuality, fertility, pornography, and any other things that are deemed useful. The Scottish Government has outlined the ways in which children and young people's views are used to influence policy in this area, including collaboration and co-design in classrooms. Their recent submission provides examples of local engagement seeking views of children and young people on sex education. It also states that the Scottish Government is in the process of revising its RSHP, its Relationships, Sexual Health and Parenthood, teaching guidance, and will run a public consultation to gather views. As part of this, it is exploring the best approach to gathering the views of children and young people. The submission concludes by stating that the Scottish Government is working to have the revised guidance available as early as possible in the 2023-2024 academic year. And I ask if members have any comments or suggestions as a consequence. Mr. Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if we could keep the petition open, and in doing so, write to Education Scotland to follow up on the committee's previous request for information and how it monitors implementation of teaching guidance. And I would also like to get a reply as quick as possible on the RSHP when they go out to consultation to see what comes back.
Yep. Any other suggestions from colleagues? Are we content? We are content. Thank you very much. That brings us to agenda item 2, which is the consideration of new petitions. And as always, just to anybody who may be following our proceedings this morning who has lodged a petition that we are considering, just to say that in advance of the consideration of petitions, a considerable amount of work is done and the views of the Scottish Government are sought in relation to every petition to help inform members as we consider petitions for the first time, together with other briefing that we've received. So we now move to agenda item 2, and we'll be considering two new petitions together, which focus on upgrades to the road network in Highland Scotland. And these are petition number 1974 to adopt the A890 as a trunk road, and petition number 1980 to adopt the A832 between Achnacheen and Gorston as a trunk road. The first of these new petitions is lodged by Derek Noble, number 1974,
And it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to adopt the A890 as a trunk road and to resolve the safety problems associated with the Strum Ferry bypass. The second petition, petition number 1980, to adopt the A832 between Achnacheen and Gorston as a trunk road, has also been lodged by Derek Noble and calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to adopt the A832 between these two destinations as a trunk road, connecting this route into the existing trunk road network. Again, we are joined by Rhoda Grant this morning, and I will set out a little of the background before inviting Rhoda to speak to the issues raised. On petition 1974, Derek tells us that the A890 is mainly single carriageway, but frequently reduces to a single track with passing places along the stretch between Attadale and Ardnarth. He highlights a history of rockfalls which have occurred since the road was opened and continue to pose a risk to the road and its users. Derek also informs us that Highland Council have undertaken feasibility studies into two alternatives to the Strum Ferry bypass, with the cost of pursuing these alternatives estimated to be between £23 and £60 million. And Derek believes this level of funding should come from central government, and it is for this reason he is calling for the road to be adopted as trunk road. In relation to petition 1980, Derek tells us that the A832 links the previously mentioned A890 to the A835, helping to complete the west to east coast road network. Derek highlights that if the Scottish Government were to adopt the A890 as a trunk road, then the A832 should also be adopted, as this would provide a trunk road connection between the existing trunk roads on the A87 and the A835. Got a complicated map in your head here. This, Derek believes, could transform connectivity between the east and west coasts of Scotland, bringing social and economic benefits at both local and national levels. Now, in responding to both of these petitions, Transport Scotland has indicated that the Scottish Government has no plans to trunk the A890 or the A832. Their response also states that there are currently no plans to undertake a formal review of the trunk road network, and that ministers keep the trunk road network under continual review, with the issue last considered following the publication of the Strategic Transport Projects Review. So, sorry, that was all quite complicated and technical. And before I ask members of the committee if there's anything they'd like to say, I invite Rhoda Grant to speak to both these petitions.
Thank you, Convener, and I'm grateful to be able to speak to them. I've been involved in the campaign to improve the Strum Ferry bypass for many years, probably much of the time that I've been elected, and I'm really pleased that Mr. Noble has brought these petitions to Parliament. As you said, Convener, parts of these roads link the current trunk road network on the route to Skye, and they're single track, as well as the big issue, which is the Strum Ferry bypass, and it's subject to landslides. And the road and the rail line run side by side at that part of the road. So these landslides impact on both road and rail line, and there's a risk to life. Children are using that road daily to get to Plockton High School. The high school is also the National Centre of Excellence for Traditional Music in Scotland. And ferry traffic to Euston Harris also use the route going up to Uig in Skye. When there's a landslide, the road can be closed for months on end, and it impacts really badly on the community and indeed on commuters. And it's concerning that it's not recognised as a trunk road, because it does link council areas, Highland Council mainland, to council areas in the Western Isles via Skye. It's also an essential road because of secondary education and medical cover. So the local hospital serving the whole area is Broadford in Skye, and it can be cut off from the community, creating huge stress and indeed disruption to care. And you can just imagine what it must be like for families with a loved one in hospital and they really can't get to them. It also cuts children off from their high school, which is also unacceptable, because the only alternative route to that route is a 130-mile diversion. So that is impossible to run over a day-to-day basis. It impacts on all services. the cost of improving the road, as you've highlighted, is beyond the financial reach of Highland Council. Highland Council already has the greatest road mileage to cover. And, you know, going by my mail bag from constituents, most of it is falling into disrepair. It's pretty grim in places. So finding that amount of money for that change or repair is impossible. I'm disappointed at Transport Scotland's response, but when they did respond, they said in the response that one of the ways they gauge whether a route should become a trunk road is provide the users with a coherent and continuous system of routes which serve destinations of importance to industry, commerce, agriculture and tourism. That was their words quoted from the response to you. I would say in response, this route is part of the NC500, which is an internationally recognised tourist route. And indeed, there's been a lot of concern about how busy that route is. It's the main route, as I said, between the Highlands and the Western Isles, the Southern Hebrides. It's the main route to a national centre of excellence, the traditional music school. And it's also critical to industry, to farming, to crofting, obviously, but also aquaculture, renewables and the decommissioning industry because of the yard at Kishorn, which is hopefully set to grow and provide much needed economic boost in that area. So I believe the route fulfills the criteria that Transport Scotland themselves have laid down. And I would maybe ask that the committee raise this with government ministers direct to try and persuade them that of the merits of this route becoming a trunk route, because it would serve the area well. And that's an area of Scotland that's been largely ignored in the past, and we really need to create jobs and indeed repopulate because it's an area of depopulation, although under a lot of pressure from obviously tourism and the holiday homes. So we need to get people back in that area to make sure it grows.
Thank you for that. I mean, I think the petition does raise important issues. Colleagues, do we have any suggestions or comments that you would like to make? Mr. Ewing?
Well, I think we should write to the Highland Council to seek its views on the issues raised by the petition and to ask for further information on their plans to develop alternative routes to the Strome Ferry bypass. I mean, I know Rhoda Grant has pursued this issue doggedly for a number of years, and rightly so. And I think in doing so, she raises a conundrum, really, which is that the Highland Council has a geographical area, if memory serves me correct, of over 25,000 square miles, nearly one third of the landmass of Scotland, 20% bigger than Wales and bigger than Belgium. And yet it has to, in its budget, cater for a huge network of roads. And the petitioners pointed particularly, and I think, Convener, you alluded to the figures, the costs of the repairs that are required are large sums and tens of millions of denomination. And I wondered, therefore, when writing to the Council, if we could specifically ask as to whether or not the overall budgetary provision, given the fact that they have such a disproportionate responsibility for road maintenance in Scotland, covering a third of the landmass, whether really the budgetary allocation to Highland Council is fair. I as a Highland MSP, albeit representing constituency, I do absolutely share the sense of grievance that the petitioners have and underlies the petition. So I just wanted to add that to the particular request. And in also, I would be interested to hear the views of local communities via their community councils. And I think that includes Lough Carron, Strome Ferry and Achmore, Blockton and Applecross as well, in order that we formally ask for their views. I don't know if there's anything else that Rhoda Grant thinks that we might usefully do, but if she does, then I would be most interested to give that sympathetic consideration as well.
Mr. Stewart.
I would very much concur with Mr. Ewing's comments. I think that local community is vitally important that we engage with, and Rhoda Grant has made a very articulate case, Convener. So, but in her representation this morning, she talked about us trying to contact the Minister, and I think that may well be another route that we should consider, just to see exactly, because, you know, it, in my opinion, it does appear that it does meet criteria that should be considered. So let's get some more clarity from the Minister on the process. It's very important that we deal with Highland Council, but as Mr Ewing has said, you know, they are limited into the resource that they have and the expanse that they have to manage across the large geographical area that they have. So I do think that the suggestion from Order Grant about the Minister is one that we should take forward.
Colleagues, have we agreed? I mean, I just wonder, in relation also to petition number 1980, we want to contact the Highland Council in relation to it, to IEM, Road Smart, the Road Haulage Association, and Visit Scotland for their views on the Achnasheen and Gorston petition too. So together with all of the suggestions that made, are we collectively content to keep the petition open and to begin our investigation by pursuing our inquiries with all those respective bodies? Are we agreed? We are. Thank you very much. That brings us to the second of our new petitions, petition number 1975, reforming the law relating to strategic lawsuits against public participation, SLAPs. And this has been lodged by Roger Mullen, who I understand is with us in the gallery and is the former member of an alternative elective legislative body that sits elsewhere in the United Kingdom. So welcome to the gallery. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to review and amend the law to prevent the use of strategic lawsuits against public participation. The Spice briefing explains that SLAPs is a term to describe court action taken by rich and powerful interests with the intention of silencing critical views. And court action can include defamation and data protection claims. The briefing highlights the Justice Committee's scrutiny of the defamation bill at stage one. The committee noted a proposal to create an unjustified threats court action and recommended further consideration by the Scottish Government on the issue. Now, currently, both the UK Government and the European Commission are working to strengthen legislation in order to tackle SLAPs. The Scottish Government response to the petition states that it does not intend to undertake a review of SLAPs, stating that the Defamation and Malicious Publication Scotland Act 2021 goes some way to address concerns. The petitioner, Roger Mullen, has provided a written response stating that there has been a lack of recognition of the scale of the problem. He raises concerns about the potential for defamation tourism if Scotland does not keep legislative pace with England, Wales and the European Union. We've also received written submissions from our colleague Michelle Thompson, MSP, the Anti-SLAP Research Hub in the University of Aberdeen and Ecclesia, all supporting the petition. The written submissions echo Roger's concerns and raise some additional issues, such as the importance of investigative journalism, the impact of frivolous litigation on the court system. The submission from Ecclesia highlights the model anti-SLAP law drafted by the UK Anti-SLAP Coalition and its key features, and it urges the Scottish Government to enact similar measures. So an interesting petition and an interesting variation in the way these matters are being pursued. Do members have any comments or suggestions for action? David Torrens?
Thank you, Convener. Can I welcome Roger Milne, who's one of my constituents, to committee today? I wonder if a committee could write to key stakeholders, including the Law Society of Scotland, National Union of Journalists and the Scottish Newspaper Society, seeking their views on the action called in the petition.
Have we agreed on that? Any further thoughts? Mr Ewing?
Yes, I'm aware of Michelle Thompson's interest in this. I think, in fact, she would have liked to have been here, except she's across the corridor in another committee's meetings. I'm just going to add that it does seem a little bit inconsistent that the Scottish Government are not planning to do more than they've said, in the light that the UK Government are, and so are the EU. And I wonder if we can get a more specific response as to in what way the Scottish Government feel that the defamation law passed fairly recently covers the issue, because the petitioner plainly is of the view that it doesn't recognise the scale of the problem. And of course, the scenario that we're concerned about here is that the UK passes legislation leaving Scotland as the jurisdiction of choice of very rich people who wish basically to attack the freedom of the press using the courts as a shield. And I do not think that is something that we want to see happening in Scotland. And therefore, I find the lack of any obvious enthusiasm of the Scottish Government disappointing. But if they do argue that this law that was passed last year is a sufficient shield, then I think we really need a lot more information and response, a lot more of a specific response than we've had at the moment. And just finally, Convener, if we don't get, and I struggle to be an optimist in life, so I hope that I'm wrong, but if we don't get that specific information, then I do think there's a case to have a hearing at which perhaps the petitioner, Aberdeen University academics, who have submitted a written response, particularly Professor Borg Bartet, who's been a key advisor to the European Union, as well as the Law Society and the Government Minister, might give evidence. In other words, if we are not satisfied by the initial responses, maybe it might be helpful to indicate in the letters to everybody that we are contemplating an inquiry, and therefore we do hope that, again, the pencil will have a high lead content when we get the response.
Well, if your glass is usually half empty and mine is usually half full, therein is a full glass that we can hope to achieve.
Working on it.
I'm maybe less surprised. He said, trying not to be party political, that they would be rushing to follow the UK government. But I think the fact that the European Union is pursuing a similar legislative solution does leave us as a bit of an outlier and potentially open as a source of comfort to those that I think we least want to potentially assist here. Moreover, I take Mr. Ewing's point. I think it's one thing for the Scottish Government to assert that the 2021 legislation will have dealt with matters here. I think we would like to understand how, in fact, we believe that is to be achieved, rather than just being it being asserted that that is the case. And I agree with Mr. Ewing. I think that this is an important issue. I think it's one the committee could pursue further in the light of the evidence we receive. And it would be useful for those people that we are contacting to know that we are minded so to do if we feel that the answers we receive are in the first instance, less than persuasive. Mr. Sweeney, you look like you seeking to intervene.
Yeah, thanks, Kevin. I'm sympathetic to the petition and the public interest of it. I'm also in agreement with the proposed recommendations and actions thus far. Might also be prudent to inform the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee of this petition, because I think it is an area of work that that committee has a locus in. Perhaps also discussing with, perhaps also invite the view of the Law Commission, and whether they've done any projects in this area thus far. It's something that usually comes through in a Law Commission bill in this kind of area. It might also be worth, I know the petitioner's present, it might also be worth looking, exploring at the members' bill route, engaging a sponsoring member of parliament to actually pursue this in the members' bill route, also engaging the non-government bills unit. It might be an opportunity to further drive this agenda, and certainly the petition could help in that regard as well. It's just another avenue by which Parliament can give effect to this.
I'm happy to pursue all those things. I mean, I hesitate now on the members' bill thing simply because, as a member of the corporate body, I know we have a record number of these before us in this Parliament already, and I struggle to see how we're going to actually, before 2026, get round to considering them. But I think certainly the other suggestions in the first instance we would want to pursue. Mr. Sweeney?
It was just a note, Convener, whilst I accept the point about parliamentary time, the ideal solution would be if groundwork was done through the members' bill route, the government might adopt the legislation and give government time to progress it, and that
well
helps
as
cajole them a bit.
As Mr. Ewing, his glass is half empty, mine is half full. Maybe that will find a successful outcome. But I think we are agreed that we think the issues raised in the petition are matters we want to pursue, and we've had detailed ways in which we will do so. I can tell the petitioner will have heard all of that. We move then to petition number 1976 to backdate council tax discounts for dementia to the date of GP certification. This has been lodged by Derek James Brown, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to require council tax discounts to be backdated to the date a person was certified as being severely mentally impaired, where they then go on to qualify for a relevant benefit. The petitioner, Derek, submitted a Freedom of Information request and found that 22 of 32 Scottish local authorities backdate council tax discounts to the date a person received their first qualifying state benefit payment, rather than the date from which they were certified as severely mentally impaired.
The SPICE briefing highlights the requirement for someone applying for attendance allowance to have needed support for at least 6 months before being eligible for the benefit, potentially creating a gap of 6 months between diagnosis and receipt of a qualifying benefit. The briefing also notes challenges in navigating benefit application processes and accessing post-diagnostic support. The Scottish Government states that local authorities have the ability to backdate applications to the later date of either the medical certification or date of application to a qualifying benefit. Because of this, the Scottish Government has no plans to amend the law in relation to council tax discounts. Now, Derek's submission details the personal experience of him and his wife. Margaret. Margaret suffers from Alzheimer's disease in England. He explains that they only became aware of his wife's entitlement to attendance allowance months after her diagnosis and then her entitlement to a council tax discount the following year. The council applied the council tax discount from the date Margaret received attendance allowance 10 months later. Do members have any comments or suggestions for action? An interesting petition, I think. Mr. Torrance?
Yes, it is, convener. Just because of also many discrepancies across local authorities. So I'm wondering if the committee could write to relevant stakeholders, including Citizens Advice Scotland, Dementia Scotland, Alzheimer's Scotland, to seek their views on the action called for in the petition. The impact of a legislative requirement to relation to eligibility for qualifying for state benefit, the variation in approach taken to assessment by local authorities across Scotland and the level of variation across Scotland for referrals for post-diagnostic support for people newly diagnosed with dementia.
Yeah, I mean, I'm also interested to know whether the Scottish Government is aware of the variation that is being applied to assessments by different local authorities across Scotland. And I think it would be useful for us to draw this to their attention with the consequential issues that arise for individuals as a result. Mr. Ewing?
The petitioner, I think, has raised a point of principle. If it is right that there should be payment of these benefits, whatever they are, from the date when the individual is certified as having dementia, then surely that should apply to all. That's the general principle. We could not and should not tolerate a system whereby, some authorities, whether they be local authorities or quangos, whatever, decide to give help to those individuals and others don't. It's a postcode lottery, I suppose, is the rather sort of more pejorative way of putting it. But it does hide the fact that there are a lot of people around Scotland who should be getting this treatment who are not getting this financial benefit, 25% reduction of council tax. So it's prima facie unfair. So all I'm saying, convener, is in addition to the action suggested that general point might be made if members are agreeable that it's a general principle, that surely there must be a general application, a universal application of the system. Whatever it is, it should be universal. And some people should not be left out. And I think we're really indebted to the petitioner for highlighting this area, because I wasn't aware of it, and I think the petitioner has done us a good service for bringing
exactly.
it to the Parliament.
No, I think I agree with that. Mr. Stewart?
I very much concur with that. I think that this has identified that there is a risk of financial loss to individuals because of that, and Mr. Ewing has articulated the fact that it should be, and we shouldn't be in the case where individuals who have been diagnosed and do have a certification are then not given the proper benefits that they're entitled to, because they say it does mean that they suffer financial loss, and that is unacceptable at any level.
No, and not only should they not be denied the benefits to which they're entitled, but that they shouldn't be entitled to receive them from a variable date depending on where they happen to live. They should receive them, I think. I have a great deal of sympathy with the argument articulated by the petitioner. I think we're all agreed then in the process as going forward. Am I correct? Yes. So, an important petition, and we will take forward the issues raised by it. Petition number 1977 requires social services to inform biological fathers of concerns about their children. This has been raised by Helen Duncan, and the petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to amend the law and update the National Guidance for Child Protection to require social services to inform biological fathers of concerns about their children. Helen tells us that social services are not required to inform a child's biological father when concerns have been raised about the welfare of their child. She highlights her own family's experience of finding out about child welfare concerns months after social work had become involved in the case. In researching the issue more broadly, Helen has become aware of situations where fathers have not been informed of child welfare concerns and are having to fight to have their child released from foster care. Responding to the petition, the Minister for Children and Young People refers to the National Child Protection Guidance in Scotland 2021 and its emphasis on listening to children, participation of and support for families, and multi-agency partnership in the core elements of child protection processes. The Minister also indicates that where child protection measures are required, social work should include fathers where appropriate and where they have an active involvement in the child's life, recognising that each set of circumstances are different and would require professional assessment before information is shared. The Minister notes that introducing an automatic notification for biological fathers could place significant risks on both children and adults. For example, in cases of domestic abuse or where the child has requested that their father is not made aware. So an interesting petition, but with, you know, conflicting emotion and consequence arising. Do members have any comments or suggestions as to how we might proceed? Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. I think, as you identify, this is an interesting petition for us, and I think we require to seek some more information from some stakeholders about where we are and where they are. So Scotland's Centre for Excellence for Children's Care and Protection, along with the Shared Parenting Scotland, the Promise Scotland, Scottish Children's Reporter Administrator and the Scottish Child Law Centre, it would be useful to seek their views and issues raised by this petition for us to gather some information, because if you rightly identified, there seemed to be a complex process ongoing in the current situation.
Thank you. Are there any other suggestions, or are colleagues content to proceed on that basis? We are. Thank you very much. Keep the petition open and proceed as suggested. The final of our new petitions this morning is petition number 1978, to allow raw milk to be sold in Scotland, lodged by Christina Rozic Esplugas. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to, and I do apologise if that wasn't even remotely correct pronunciation. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to allow raw drinking milk to be sold in Scotland, bringing it in line with England, Wales and Northern Ireland, and allow farmers the opportunity to sell unpasteurised drinking milk. Christina highlights the sale of raw drinking milk is permitted in the rest of the UK as well as in most European countries. She believes that it is time for raw milk to stop being considered a public health hazard, and notes that measures can be put in place to control for food safety, as is the case with many other food products. Now, responding on behalf of the Scottish Government, Food Standards Scotland state that raw drinking milk has historically been recognised as a high risk to public health due to its association with a number of food poisoning outbreaks in Scotland. They note that mandatory pasteurisation of cows' drinking milk was introduced in 1983, and it was then extended to drinking milk from all farmed animals in 2006. They suggest that since then, illnesses linked to the consumption of raw milk in Scotland have virtually disappeared. Food Standards Scotland has also highlighted a report from the UK Scientific Advisory Committee on the microbiological safety of food in 2018. And this concluded that there had been an increase in the microbiological risk associated with the consumption of raw drinking milk in the UK. As a result, there are currently no plans to lift the ban on direct sales of raw drinking milk in Scotland. Do members have any comments or suggestions on how we might proceed? This does seem to me to be very clear guidance from the Scottish Government in this instance. Mr. Torrens?
I was just wondering, because of the guidance from Food Standards Scotland, the historic evidence and the weighty scientific community, if we could close a petition under 15.7 of standing orders on that basis, because I don't think the Food Standard Agency Scotland is going to shift, or the Scottish Government, on this.
Yeah, I mean, how do colleagues feel? I mean, we could obviously explore the matter further with the Food Standards Agency, but the direction in relation to Scotland seems to be pretty clear to us, and I'm not sure whether that's going to lead to a productive route forward. Mr. Sweeney?
Thanks, Convener. I was just curious as to why there's a difference in jurisdictions, that's all. I mean, I see the point about whether it's going to go anywhere, but I'm just curious as to find out more why it's not seen as such an issue in other parts of the UK, but as here, and perhaps there is. And does the farming industry have a view about whether this would improve their commercial opportunity? I don't know.
Well, clearly the 1983 ban will have been introduced pre-devolution. The ban in 2006 would be post-devolution, presumably. So, I mean, I don't know whether we were following any kind of national advice at the time. I mean, the issue is whether in extending our investigation into all of this, we are better informed in the circumstances, but no further forward in terms of being able to take the petition anywhere, because the direction from the two agencies, the government and the Scottish Food Standards Agency, is clear. So I just wonder what the mood of colleagues is. I mean, Mr. Torrance has proposed that we close it on that basis, but are we minded, colleagues? What are our thoughts?
I'm content to close it, Convener, because I think we do know what the answer is going to be, and it's only prolonging the situation. So I think that it is clear cut as to where we are with it at this stage.
Are we minded to close it, but maybe nonetheless think it worthwhile just to ask the question so that we have the answer to hand? I mean, what's the... Mr. Ewing, Mr. Sweeney, I think, is erring on the side, Mr. Sweeney, I think, of exploring things a bit further before we move to close. Mr. Ewing?
Well, I suppose our primary function is to give voice to petitioners. I mean, I agree with Mr. Torrance that I think there is just a zero chance that the FSA are going to move, and for the very good reason that, as I understand it, the rationale is that raw milk can carry Salmonella, E. coli, Listeria, Campylobacter, if I pronounced that correctly, cause food poisoning, and we've seen very serious illnesses, including death, in other examples of other foodstuffs resulting in food poisoning. So it's a very serious matter indeed, and I do agree that it's most unlikely that view is going to change, irrespective of what we get. But on the other hand, we have got a duty to the petitioner. The petitioner's new, it's just been lodged. So I think, as Mr. Sweeney says, it would be interesting to know why in England this has been made legal and what the experience has been here. I don't know that we're in a position to conduct a detailed inquiry, but I think in the interests of fairness to the petitioner, that question should be asked, because it's not clear to me why in England it has been legalised, given that the health experts in Scotland say that the risks are so serious that the ban must remain in place. So maybe I'm being a bit softer than Mr. Torrance, being a relative newbie, but you know, I think we do owe some kind of duty to the petitioner. So writing to the FSA in Scotland, and perhaps in England as well, to ask why in England they have, it would be interesting and illuminating to see why in England they've done it, and whether or not, having made it legal, they've had any cases of food poisoning, for example.
Well, it's clearly reassuring to those of us in the committee that the Scottish National Party is such a broad church in terms of cooperation of views and personalities. But I think that the committee's kind of largely agreed in where we think the final outcome of this might be. But I take the point. We have a conclusion without actually understanding why there is a variation. And in the first instance, I think it might be useful for us to have some further understanding of why that variation occurs. Are you content with us to pursue it on that basis, Mr.
Convener, I'm quite happy to withdraw my recommendations and write to...
But it's not so much you're withdrawing them, as I think we're deferring them subject to that further advice being received.
Until we get the information back.
Yeah, I think that makes perfect sense. I should... Sorry, Mr. Sweeney.
Curious, is there a successor to the Milk Marketing Board? Does that exist anymore, or has that been disbanded long ago? I was just curious because I remember there was an actual national authority that dealt with milk production.
Yes, but you're looking at me as if I ought to be an authority in these matters. While Mr. Ewing and I may be at the older end of the lifespan of the committee membership, I have to say I'm not an expert in these matters, but no doubt others can.
Which is the National Trade Association, so they might be worth asking the question of as well.
Right.
I was just quickly looking to see if I could find out more whilst we were talking.
Well, I mean, I suppose the one other area that we might usefully ask any information of is the industry itself, because I'm not quite sure whether the petition is arising out of an industry concern or whether it sits outside of an industry concern which may not exist in Scotland, for all I know.
as well. But I suspect that their concern and their members' concern and dairy farmers'
will be for reputational risk relating to
overall reputation of dairy farmers, because you know it's a highly specialised area.
That would be my thought, but I think we could ask that too.
You know, they do a brilliant job. They were highlighted on This Farming Life. If those who had watched the programme yesterday evening saw dairy farmers in the south of Scotland who, you know, provide a great service for Scotland. And I imagine that they would be concerned about reputational risk of any incident involving food poisoning of any milk.
Right. Well, from our liberal consumption of the milk of human life, we come to the end of our consideration of new petitions. I should have begun the meeting by asking members if they're content to take item 3 in private. And on the basis that members are, that brings us to the end of the public section of our meeting this morning. And we will resume again on the 1st of February. Thank you very much.